be an extremely costly exercise. The council would be required to first purchase the land and then spend thousands of dollars to build picnic areas and trails. But Alderman Robinson claims it's worth it.
I think it's important that we retain bushland in our city, and this is a most significant area. It's 125 acres and it provides an excellent green belt between Blackbutt right here to Jesmond Park.
What do you intend to do about it?
Well, I hope that the council will support the motion, and I hope that we can also encourage the state government to get funds to purchase this area so it's preserved for all time.
Now that'd be quite expensive, wouldn't it?
It will be expensive, but I think the alternative is Newcastle just being a sprawl of commercial and residential area. We just need bushland so badly.
Edward Park was a venue for the now annual event of kite flying. The Hunter Valley Scots Club, which has 130 members, has only been in existence for 2 years, but it has a number of activities planned for Scottish Heritage Week. On Tuesday night, it's planned to hold a ceilidh, or Scottish dance, to make people more aware of their Scottish heritage. A special guest at the ceilidh will be the chieftain of the MacLeod clan of Rase, Mr. Torquil Roderick MacLeod. The Heritage Week will culminate in Sydney next Sunday with the gathering of the clans. The tournament, which was held at Charlestown Golf Club, attracted about 300 players from all over the Newcastle area. Prizes were donated by local businessmen to help further the cause of the boys from Lake Macquarie Junior Soccer Club's under 14 touring team. The team's coach, Mr. Richard Olsen, says the boys will play some 20 games on their 32-day tour of Germany, Scotland and England.
It's organised by a culture exchange, and I think the culture exchange trip plus the experience with the soccer and everything for them will be very good.
I believe the team that went over there last year was very successful.
Yes, the Macquarie under 14 team, though we came second in the Ipswich Cup. They were beaten in the final, we came second.
Officers from universities in New South Wales, Queensland and the ACT met in Newcastle today to discuss ways of bringing the community closer to the academic world, in particular the field of science. Research has shown that the public has very little knowledge of the range of scientific work conducted throughout Australia, but who's to blame for the communication gap?
I think to some extent academics have to take some responsibility for the lack of communication between universities and the community outside, in that they haven't realised the extent to which they should be communicating about what they're doing and the way in which the work that they are doing in universities, research work, relates to the community outside and has a direct relevance to people outside. I think more academics ought to be explaining what they're doing and the importance of what they're doing.
Today at the late Macquarie Yacht Club, Tia Maria's skipper Peter Sorensen, along with some of Australia's top yachting journalists, gathered for the media preview of the Sailing Challenge 83. And here's what Newcastle and the Hunter Valley will be backing to win. A highly sophisticated scow imported from America by local businessman Fred Williams earlier this year. But whether it can beat the fastest 18-footer in the world over a series of races on the lake in mid-December and another series on Botany Bay in February is a very interesting question. With Challenge 83 being launched in style today, how will the man behind it, Mr. Williams, see it if our town is well beaten?
I don't know whether I've got a lot to lose. I mean, anybody that's a sportsman has a go, and we think that this is something different. We've got as good a crew as you can find in Australia, we think.
There's little doubt our town has a top crew with former world 16-foot skiff champion John Moore at the helm. And it's largely with Mr. Moore that the fate of our town will be decided.
I'm quite sure the boat's capable of doing it, and I'm sure the crew's capable of pulling the right shots, and after the modifications are carried out to the boat in the next 7 days, I think we'll be good enough.
...35-year-old Bill Poole from Singleton has vanished. He was last seen flying low near rocks at the base of Dudley Bluff at about 6 o'clock last night. When he failed to turn up at a meeting with friends, a search was started. At about midnight last night, his abandoned car was found, but no trace of Poole. The search was carried out during the night, and early this morning, the rescue helicopter was called in to make an aerial check. The police launched Doyle, also checked the coastline, while foot patrols scoured the rugged bushland. Poole is described by fellow gliding club members as very experienced. He holds the distance record for the year and was to be presented a medal this Friday night. Police now say Poole's large blue and white glider would have been found by now if it had crashed on land. They now believe the kite has come down in the sea, and hang gliders don't float. Meanwhile, 26-year-old Spears Point hang glider David Clark is still seriously ill in Sydney's Royal North Shore Hospital after he crashed over an airstrip near Jerry's Plains yesterday.
Seems that deciding when it's safe to swim at beaches near the Burwood Beach treatment works will have to remain an educated guess. A meeting convened at Newcastle City Hall today attempted to put the pollution into perspective. But while being told in no uncertain terms that the State Pollution Control Commission considers the Burwood Beach sewage treatment plant as unsatisfactory, Mr. Peter Yates, an SPCC expert, said that judging water standards against levels set by the Commission is not on.
The fecal coliform criteria, the bacteriological criteria, cannot be used for the day-to-day assessment of bathing water acceptability. They are only suitable for design and long-term assessment purposes.
Mr. Yates said the only practical way to assess pollution on a daily basis was to look at the water. He said that's how he decides if he can swim at Manly Beach. If it's dirty, he doesn't swim. Mr. Yates made it clear that assessing pollution in the surf is a particularly imprecise science at the moment. So until a new sewage works is built, it seems the only answer is to look before you swim.
Six-year-old Terry Gauthier started taking antipsychotic drugs for hyperactivity when she was three. What her doctor is describing, however, is not hyperactivity.
These are constant movements. They really interfere with things like walking.
What is she supposed to be doing now?
She's supposed to be sitting still.
But Terry can't sit still. She has a new problem caused by drugs. When the usual treatment for hyperactivity failed, doctors put her on antipsychotics. The result? Tardive dyskinesia.
You were wiggling in your seat?
Yeah, when I was in the first grade.
How come?
because I couldn't sit still.
Off all drugs for 2 months now, Terry is much better. Her problem should not have come as much of a surprise.
All right, good.
The drug company's own films list numerous side effects and even complications of tardive dyskinesia.
Psychological reactions ranging from embarrassment to suicide.
Being aware of the disease's first signs is important because in about a third of the cases, it will disappear if caught early and the drugs stopped. Yet where antipsychotics are used most, in public institutions, studies find little evidence anyone is watching. New York State surveyed 6 mental hospitals.
The monitoring was routinely absent, the evidence of monitoring for side effects. And that's a very disturbing finding.
Psychiatrists predict that within the next decade, new antipsychotics will come on the scene, drugs that will not cause tardive dyskinesia. Until then, it always will be a benefit-risk decision, but one many patients and their families feel they have a right to participate in, considering who may be involved.
To allow a yacht with a high mast through the channel. The northern side locked into the up position and traffic was stopped for 45 minutes. Main roads workmen winched the bridge closed manually and are now repairing the fault, and it's unlikely any yachts will be allowed through until the fault is rectified. Some of the peak hour traffic this morning was redirected around the western side of Lake Macquarie.
Two fishermen are no strangers to mishap. Yesterday's was the third narrow escape they have had in the past 5 years. This time they will be unable to retrieve their trawler Falcon, which sunk in deep water. But today, both were happy just to have escaped with their lives.
Captain in
Mr. Fran says there were times in the water when he was certain they were going to die. Using buoys, the two men paddled from their sinking trawler, and after fishermen from another vessel failed to see them, made their way to the shore.
I know how many tons. He was swimming all the time. Few move and the rest. Few move and rest, splashing with the legs until our legs get cramp and frozen. Worst thing was swell coming, because half of your body was out of water, and when swell come, give you new water that was painful cold, making us shake and so on. But we brave each other all the way. We'll make it. We must make it. First was a last mile, so that was a very, very slow journey. I think that last mile took us 3 hours.
When the two finally landed on the beach, their ordeal was far from over. They were cold, wet, exhausted, and still hours away from help.
So we just come on the
Mr. shore. Mr. Skoljarov walked for 3 hours from the beach at Mungo Brush towards Tea Gardens. Just as he thought he had used all his strength, he found a group of campers who drove him to the police station.
I left my mate on the road and I went to find some help, you know, for, you know, to if we stay on the road, probably freeze, you know, to death or something like that until morning.
And so you walked for some time?
Yeah, I was walking for 3 hours until I come in some camp up there. When you fight for your life, you know, it's anything is possible, like.
The first of 7 heats to decide the state diamond class champion was sailed in moderate breezes on the lake this afternoon and provided close racing. Fast 9-metre keel boats cut a fine spectacle as they slash their way around the course, tacking and jostling for the advantage. In the latter stages of the race, two boats had moved ahead to fight out first across the line. The provisional honours eventually went to the Middle Harbour entry, Lucy Ann, seen here, sail number 142, ahead of Lake Macquarie's Hypertension, also in picture, sail number 96. Third was another Lake Macquarie boat, Mistress Kate. The series continues tomorrow and next weekend.
Mr. David Webster from the Newcastle Cycleways Movement says hundreds of our children are killed or injured on the roads each year as they ride their bikes. He says there are four main safety measures that parents can take.
The first one is to make sure the bike is in a sound mechanical condition, particularly the brakes. Constable Tony Templin in the bicycle enforcement program is finding that the majority of bicycles are in a deplorable condition. The second main point is to ensure that they ride safely on the roads. Many accidents to younger cyclists are due to the cyclist's own poor, irresponsible and illegal road behaviour. In particular, we would urge that they ride on the correct side of the road and obey all road rules, particularly at traffic lights and stop signs.
What about the visibility of the rider and the bike?
Visibility is another very important issue with safety. We would like to see all cyclists wearing highly visible clothing. During daytime, yellow or day glow orange are very good colours to wear. In fact, we find that after many accidents, the motorist has said they didn't see the cyclist.
For the Newcastle Tramways Museum at Warrabrook Estate. The Kern Corporation has given the Tramways Group a 99-year lease on the 3.5-kilometre square site. The museum currently has 13 Sydney, Newcastle and Melbourne trams in various stages of disrepair. Slowly, they're beginning to restore them. Some will be used for spare parts, but it's hoped that when the museum is opened in 1986, there will be 7 operational and 2 stationary trams brought back to their former splendour. Mr. Russell Femister from the Tramways Group says the 1.75-kilometre tram line will be the longest museum line on the east coast.
First of all, we had to build a building on it to house these tram cars. Without a building, without some sort of cover, the trams will just deteriorate. We've seen that time and time again with other museums and other exhibits, especially the 3 Melbourne cars that we've got here. You know, they rot very quickly out in the weather.
What else do you intend to do here?
We intend to lay a track which will run around the southern side of the estate, which will run approximately 1.75 kilometres. We intend to put poles in and hang overhead wire to run them on, set up a static display, and also in this building that is on the block, we intend to put a mini movie theatre to show people what trams were like when they actually ran in Newcastle, Sydney and Melbourne.
The use of steam on the South Maitland line ended in June this year. The historic line has now been placed under a preservation order issued under the Heritage Act. But there have been accusations that some dismantling of equipment has taken place, and in any case, unless the steam locomotives are properly mothballed, their usefulness in the future may be doubtful. The old workshop has recently been closed down by Coal and Allied, its owners, with former steam engine fitters transferred elsewhere. The National Trust admits that the use of the line and at least some of the steam engines for tourism might not ultimately prove feasible, but it wants the option kept open in the meantime.
The preservation of the line and of the steam engines obviously would need money. Who should put up that money?
Well, I believe that the company has benefited to a significant extent over time from the from the railway line and the South Maitland premises. I believe it should be partially responsible for putting up some of the money. I believe the state government, through its various tourist authorities and so on, could also be putting up some of the money.
But nobody seems to be rushing to come forward with the money.
No, there was no great rush of benefactors for this one.